Members, the next item on the order paper is a motion on openness and transparency from the Executive. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. As 2 amendments have been selected and are published on the Marshall list, an additional 15 minutes has been added to the total time. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. The proposer of each amendment will have 10 minutes to propose and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly expresses its concern at ongoing problems with openness and transparency from the Executive and the implications for public trust and confidence.
Thank you. I call Dr. Stephen Farry to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This motion provides an opportunity to make clear the growing unease at matters around openness, transparency and accountability on the part of the Northern Ireland Executive. We have deliberately kept this motion on a high-level basis to allow for a free-flowing and wide-ranging debate. We have consciously tried to avoid getting bogged down around any particular remedies as such, but have no difficulty with either of the proposed amendments. But there are a range of issues that it is important that we do highlight in this particular debate. Over the past few months, we have seen numerous breaches of what should be the accepted standards of good governance, including disregard for assembly processes, unnecessary secrecy, control freakery and cronyism, to name just a few. I suspect that those today who will seek to defend the Executive will claim that their antics are little different from what happens in other governments. So let's be clear, what is happening here is at the extreme end of the spectrum of what is supposed to be to pass for democratic government. We often hear the mantra that we won the election. But democracy means more than just majority voting. It's about good governance, human rights and the rule of law. Others may dismiss this debate as part of the Stormont bubble, but this stuff really matters in terms of the nature and quality of outcomes for the people of Northern Ireland. Good governance, including effective scrutiny, does lend itself to better value for money and maximises the best use of resources, allowing more to be done in terms of either investing in the key drivers of our economy or expanding public services. Indeed, there is a persistent trend of DUP and Sinn Féin MLAs on Assembly scrutiny committees being reluctant to count on scrutiny of their own ministers. Indeed, this has had a particular effect on the committee of the Executive Office, on this predecessor, the Committee for OFM-DFM, as there's a majority of members there coming from the ministerial parties. There are numerous examples of decisions or handling of issues that give substance to this motion. Let's take, for example, the appointment of the Executive Press Secretary. And before the opponents of the motion starting to engage in whataboutery in terms of what other parties have done, let me be clear, the issue at stake is not that the Executive chose to headhunt somebody, let alone that that person is David Gordon. Rather, the concerns are that the First Minister and Deputy First Minister thought it was appropriate to use the royal prerogative in an area already covered by legislation and didn't use one of the already generous special advisor allowances to accommodate the post, which happens in other jurisdictions. Turning to the NAMBA scandal, it's a matter of some bewilderment that the DUP and Sinn Féin chose to close ranks to water down what would be a more far-reaching motion in the Assembly. The issues at stake here are not just criminal, but also relate to the degree of due diligence around public appointments and the approach to decision-making within Stormont Castle. Also in the news this past week was the failure of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister to disclose in a timely manner the document on implications of Brexit prepared by their civil servants almost a year before the referendum. A lot has been said about this in public. But one particularly troubling aspect is that it took a Freedom of Information request to produce it. But the FOI was tabled in February, and while most normal public bodies would take their duties to produce documentation within the 20 working days, it was only released on the rather convenient day after the referendum. The processing of FOIs is governed by statute, and compliance is not supposed to filter in around political convenience. But this is not an isolated example. The response rate of OFM-DFM, in particular to FOI deadlines, is appalling. Of course, it is conceivable that they have used the royal prerogative to change the Freedom of Information legislation to exempt themselves from this requirement, just haven't told us. The pattern of no respect for compliance with FOI deadlines is replicated in terms of the time taken to answer questions. The protocols governing the timescales for responses are readily flouted with impunity. And again, some departments and ministers are serial offenders. Surprise, surprise, OFM, DFM and now the Executive Office as the worst offender. Yet some ministers from a range of parties have proven in the past that it is possible to respect deadlines around FOIs and questions, including both David Ford and myself. Also, in terms of ministers offering themselves for accountability, we are seeing a reluctance to make major announcements in the form of ministerial statements to the Assembly, so providing members with the opportunity to question. Yep.
I've listened to the member now for about 4.5 minutes, and I'm grateful to him for giving way. I presume all of these myriad of problems that he's describing never occurred at Dell when he was the minister.
Indeed, that's the point. I think I made numerous statements to the Assembly to the point that the chair of my committee was almost frowning in terms of the number of times he was forced to come in and receive them, listen to them.
I'll add to the member's contribution there. As minister, I will admit that his openness to the Dáil committee as a minister left many other ministers in the shadow, and including a lot of the DUP members. And I'm not even sure how often OFM DFM actually appeared in front of the OFM DFM committee in the last mandate.
And this is a spontaneous coordination within across the opposition, I stress as well.
I thank the member for giving way. The records can be checked, but if memory serves me correct, I think there was a period of more than a year where the First Minister or Deputy First Minister failed to even report to the OFM-DFM committee in the last mandate. Hopefully that's something that will change.
Anyway, I congratulate Mr. Stalford on a very successful intervention there. Another case of secrecy that risks becoming counterproductive is the way in which the Health Minister is currently sitting on the Bangor report. This report was commissioned by the previous minister with a key desire to build a cross-party consensus on a generational change in health and social care. And all the main parties were engaged and consulted in the development of the proposals. This report has been with the minister since the start of the summer, and there seems to be no intention of publishing it until the department has agreed its own response. This approach strikes me as missing an opportunity to continue the informed debate and to build consensus, particularly given the current state of the health service and what is at stake in terms of public finances. But poor governance extends more widely in terms of the nature of the budget process. The budget for this financial year was presented to ministers, well, those outside the 2D parties, with 20 minutes before it was actually adopted. And to be clear, I'm not talking about the draft budget, but the actual final budget. The executive may well have been facing an incredibly tight schedule that was not of their making, but there was still space for some structured engagement with key stakeholders. There was an air of getting the matter out of the way in order to progress the DUP leadership transition. We're now facing a similar situation for the next financial year. Even with the tight timescale arising from the audit statement, lessons do need to be learned from last year, however the indications are not encouraging. Drilling down into budget changes also becomes more difficult whenever we look at the issue around monitoring rounds. And what happened in June, I think, is a lesson that we have to avoid, where there was a lack of detail from the Finance Minister and indeed a lack of engagement more generally with committees. The Public Accounts Committee is now doing its job in trying to get to the bottom around the ongoing problems arising from the Department of Enterprise, Trade and Investments black hole in terms of public finances. But we also have a growing culture of major financial decisions being taken without approval of a proper business case. I do accept that there are some cases where ministerial directions are appropriate, but that argument becomes weaker whenever the scale of resources increases. Concerns have been expressed that the decision-making process, including consideration of value for money and opportunity costs, related to the subsidy to United Airlines and also the financial support to the City of Derry Airport. Perhaps the most serious example in this regard was the decision of a Sinn Féin minister to relocate Dard and Idara to Ballykelly without a business case. This actually costs more than the status quo and does create major questions around business continuity. The dawning that this project is in difficulty reflects the dangers of not fully exploring all of the risks through a business case. I'm going to finish, Mr. Speaker, with the issue of the Social Investment Fund, which is a walking recipe for bad governance. The fund seems to exist as a means to bypass the normal purposes of distributing of how government engages with the community sector and delivers employability and deprivation issues. The intent seems to be to direct funding to particular favoured organisations. It has been dogged by delays and controversies, and in particular the recent announcement in regard to East Belfast sends out a terrible message in the aftermath of the Fresh Start commitments on addressing paramilitarism. Perhaps we may be better off if the Social Investment Fund was wound up and the money reinvested in our health service. The issues that are addressed by the Social Investment Fund are not something unique or new. They're things that could have been addressed in the past by my department, the Department for Employment and Learning, and the Department for Social Development, through proper procurement measures, which can actually engage with the community and voluntary sector. Whenever we end up bypassing those procedures, there's a whole range of risks that are being borne by government, and we're just seeing the tip of the iceberg in that regard. I beg to move the motion. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I call Mr. Stephen Agnew to move amendment number 1.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And Mr. Speaker, it is the height of arrogance and disrespect that when we're debating a motion around transparency, openness and accountability, that the Executive Office, with its 4 ministers, could not send one to respond to this debate, or even indeed in the suite of ministers we have in government, because we call on the whole executive. Any one could have answered on behalf of the executive, yet not one is here today to answer the criticisms that have been made. I'll give way.
Would the member agree that potentially the response from that empty glass sitting up there could be more beneficial?
Well, I think that's effective, that what we are getting. And it highlights the point that is being made at this debate. As was alluded to by the proposer of the motion, we have an executive that says, we have the votes, we have the power, we don't have to. And if ever again I hear a minister say to me, we don't need legislation for this, this executive has shown if it is not required to do it, it will not do it. There is no respect, there is no accountability, there is no openness, and that has to change if we're to have a genuine, thriving democracy, if our devolution is to meet the standards of other devolved regions and indeed other parliaments. Accountability requires transparency, and for ministers to be accountable, we have to know about the decisions they're making and how they're making them. We have seen the number of issues over the summer that we would not even have known about were it not for investigative journalists bringing them to light. The appointment of David Gordon, yes, it was announced, but the process was kept hidden only for the work of Sam McBride to uncover the mechanism used. The Brexit document, again, the proposer alluded to, freedom of information request, the legal responsibility ignored until it was convenient to publish the information. We've heard the First Minister say she never saw that document. Well, I put it to the First Minister. If I knew there was a referendum coming up that had such significance to Northern Ireland, I would be asking my officials, have you done any work on the outcomes of this? So there's 2 possibilities. The First Minister saw that document and chose not to publish it. Or the First Minister never asked to see that document, and in which case she is not on top of her department in such a major issue.
Point of order, Mr. Lyons.
It seems to me that Mr. Agnew is accusing the First Minister of misleading the House with the comments that she made yesterday in regards to that document. Would the Speaker be able to rule on that?
I don't believe that is a point of order, Mr. Lyons. You've made your point on the record. Mr. Agnew.
And Mr. Speaker, I made the point there was 2 possibilities. I didn't say which one was true. We've got the situation business cases in Northern Ireland, which are ordinarily published in at Westminster, are not even in some times in existence. And I look at issues such again over the summer, the business case for the bailout of Derry City Airport, the bailout of the Newark flight. Where did this money come from? Where was the business case? Where was the accountability to this Assembly? We are operating at lower standards than what we should expect of a devolved government. Coming to the amendment, Mr. Speaker, this is, as a former member of the Standards and Privileges Committee, The issue of the ministerial code of conduct came up time and time again. Indeed, I was checking the figures in the last mandate. The Standards and Privileges Committee received 5 complaints against ministers. On each occasion, we were unable to investigate and had to tell the complainant that that there was no process for which their complaint could be investigated. The only recourse for the general public is judicial review, which we know is prohibitively expensive for most people. We as members are held to the Northern Ireland Assembly Code of Conduct, and rightly so, and we have an independent process for investigations of complaints. And I would argue that on this, the ministers and the executive have nothing to fear. Well, at least if they're acting with probity and integrity. Because we have had the situation, it worked against both the complainant and those complained of. We have the situation, I'll give one example because I made the allegation of a breach. When the now First Minister was Deputy Minister, she licensed an area for fracking. As it turned out, her husband owned land within that licensed area. I argued that that should have been declared. She argued it wasn't required. I argued that there had been a breach of the code. What is left is suspicion in the general public. The Minister, Arlene Foster, Minister for Enterprise, she was then, can declare her innocence. I can allege her guilt, but we never get a conclusion. We never get satisfaction. If I'm making a spurious allegation, that should be brought into light. There should be an independent process, and I should be told, should be put in my place and told that was a scurrilous accusation. But equally, if a minister has acted inappropriately, there should be an independent, transparent process by which they're investigated. And they should be held, as members are, to account for their actions in the role of their minister, as a minister. What is the point of having a ministerial code of conduct if there is no mechanism for investigating breaches of it? It effectively is not worth the paper it's written on. And we have, again, that's a historical case. We have, again, with the allegations around the Brexit document, and again, I come back to the point. I can't stand here and say with absolute certainty that the ministerial code has been broken. I suspect it has. But what I would say to the First and Deputy First Minister and to every other executive minister, open yourself up to independent, transparent and fair process. If you have done nothing wrong, then you have nothing to fear. That's what I hear from the opposite benches quite regularly. So if that is the case, why does the executive not come forward with a proposed amendment to the ministerial code to initiate a process by which these allegations can be heard and adjudicated upon in an independent matter? And often the stumbling block in these cases is cost. Well, we already currently pay our standards commissioner in the region the overall cost of the role and its office as £60,000 a year. That could be the cost of a single judicial review that would have to be taken to investigate allegations of breaches of the ministerial code. There is a way of doing this. We can extend the role of the standards commissioner. We have the mechanism in place. We have the model in place because it's how we investigate members. And what we cannot continue to have, if we're to meet the levels of democracy, accountability and transparency that we want, we cannot have the situation where I, as a member, am open to scrutiny, but a minister of our government is not open to the same level of scrutiny. I'll give way.
The member also accepts that there are a number of different accountability mechanisms that are set up under the Assembly, and one of those is the committee. And the committee legitimately scrutinises ministers. And the committee, well, the members may laugh, but there are procedures there. And the member has made some comments about the First Minister, Arlene Foster, and the First Minister did speak to the Chair and the Vice Chair of the Deputy Committee in relation to this matter. She made it clear, both publicly and to this House, that she considered that she had no conflict of interest, and she outlined that to the committee, a committee with the role to scrutinise that minister.
Well, I'm sure every criminal would love it just that they were able to go to the court and say, but I am sure I have done nothing wrong, Mr. Judge. Wouldn't that be a wonderful judicial system?
Isn't in fact the parallel? It would be like having the criminal law, but no courts to adjudicate whether or not there's been a breach. We have a ministerial code, but no process to adjudicate whether or not there's a breach. It's as farcical as that.
It is indeed, Mr. Speaker, and I repeat the point. The then Deputy Minister was very clear that she felt she had not breached the code. I was very clear.
Member to conclude his remarks.
I will indeed. I was very clear that I felt that she had. What we need is a process to decide who is right.
I call Mr. Mike Nesbitt to move amendment number 2. Mr. Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, I so move, but let me also make clear that we support amendment number 1 and also thank the movers of this motion. I suppose fundamentally it comes down to a simple question. Who represents the primary authority? Is it the judiciary? Is it the executive? Is it the media, the so-called fourth estate? Or is it this chamber? And I put it to you, Mr. Speaker, it is this chamber and the 108 members herein, because we are the lawmakers. Now, as we know, members of the executive can be law amenders. And let me put it on the official record of this House that I have discovered that the Deputy First Minister, the self-styled, proud and principled Republican, has conferred upon himself the powers of a monarch to change the laws, not once, not twice, but no fewer than 3 times in league with the DUP First Minister. And on all 3 occasions, it was to make appointments. Now, we have yet to get to the names of the other 2. But clearly, it was so important to them to get the right person, as they would see it, that they changed the law to make that effect. And for a Republican to give himself the power of a king is nothing short of perverse. As perverse as booking a fine art establishment in Birmingham to sip champagne with the Conservative Party you've been deriding for austerity for years. And of course, executive ministers are not just law amenders. Sometimes they ignore the opportunity to amend the law without reference to their executive colleagues. Sammy Wilson, as finance minister, could have said to his executive colleagues, the law of defamation in England and Wales has been changed and we could adopt it with a legislative consent motion. But he did not. And 3 years later, we find the current incumbent of the finance ministry, Mr. Mulier, sitting on a report commissioned from Dr. Andrew Scott, which recommends a change in the law, and yet the minister continues to sit on the report, as the Minister for Health sits on the Bengoa report, as we hear this morning on our radio and in our newspapers and on our television screens, of hospital waiting lists, not of a year, not of a year and a half, but now of 2 years and 2 years plus. And the defamation, Mr. Speaker, was important in terms of scrutiny because we do rely on the media, and the point has been made already in this debate. We do not have a second chamber, as they do in Dublin and in London, and until the last couple of months, we did not have an official opposition. And I note that the First Minister, apparently, will set down her champagne flute long enough to praise the development of an official opposition in this House and admit it has forced the 2 parties of the executive to raise their game. And that is a good thing, and I think we can all agree on that. But openness and transparency is not just for this chamber. It is also for the committees, and the point has been made by Mr. Little, who was deputy chair of the Committee of OFM-DFM in the last mandate, that there was a point when we went for over a year without hearing from the principals, the First Minister and Deputy First Minister. What he could also have told the House was that the committee had to threaten to use its legal powers under the 1998 Northern Ireland Act to force them to come to the House. But it wasn't just about the principles, Mr. Speaker, it was about the information flow, late cancellations of briefings by officials, late responses to requests from the committee for information, and the late delivery of papers, which was so ridiculous that one Wednesday we received a sheaf of financial information at 1:55, 5 minutes before the committee was due to consider that information. Nobody can say to me that that is good government. And looking ahead, Mr. Speaker, if these two parties are going to achieve outcome-based accountability government, which will involve cross-cutting across two or more government departments, we must not allow our statutory committees, whose job is to assist and advise ministers, to fall behind and remain in silos. And it is a role, Mr. Speaker, I know that you are already giving consideration to. I think it's something that the chairperson's liaison group has to give consideration to, and something that we as MLAs must give consideration to. There is no point waiting for the executive to advise us, because they couldn't even be bothered to turn up for today's debate. Looking back, when we had all those difficulties in the last mandate, with the late delivery and the cancellation and all the rest, I went privately because I was interested in sorting it out rather than grabbing a headline. And with the permission of the committee, I went privately to see FM and DFM. And this is what happens. You go to the east wing of this building and you have a private chat and say, here's a problem. And they direct you to the west wing and say, that's where the problem lies. So you walk the 365 feet from one wing to the other and you have a private chat and you're told, actually, the problem lies at the east wing because we have cleared it here at the west. But it's not just about us in this chamber or this committee, Mr. Speaker. What about the people out there who rely on us? Let me give you an example. A social economy organisation contacted me recently. They wanted to give me a briefing about a development that they imagine could reimagine a famous area of this city. It seems to me a very good plan, but of course they need finance. So they applied for a grant from the executive. They were unsuccessful, and they were advised the application had been determined to be of merit, but it had not been considered of sufficient strategic priority to progress at this time. Not of sufficient strategic priority, Mr. Speaker. So they wrote and asked if there'd been a scoring matrix. And there was. And my goodness, in terms of contribution to strategic objectives, what did they score? 5 out of 5. Contribution to an existing strategic plan or scheme, what did they score out of 5? They scored 5. They got a perfect 10 in terms of contribution to strategic development, and yet in the previous letter they were told it was the lack of sufficient strategic priority that was holding them back. 2 letters signed by the same person, one saying lack of strategic vision, but the second one said it was because of the cocktail of funding. That was the problem. And yet they know there is a prior example of a very similar scheme in another city in this country which had the exact same cocktail of funding. This is not open and this is not transparent government, Mr. Speaker. So we certainly support the motion. We certainly support our amendment, but also that of Mr. Agnew. It is just wrong that members of this House are under greater scrutiny and threat of sanction than members of the Northern Ireland Executive. It's one of those fundamentals which at any moment can further undermine public confidence in all our devolved institutions. Mr. Speaker, this was supposed to be a new era for the Executive. And maybe it is because the shutters seem to have come down more firmly than ever before down at Stormont Castle. Monetary grounds, which my committee used to pore over and take briefings on what was being bid for, are now a mystery to the other members of this House because the DUP and Sinn Féin have decided, for their own purposes, not to disclose monitoring bids anymore. And the existence of that paper on the implications of a Brexit, which Mr. Agnew focused on a minute ago, I listened very carefully to the First Minister's responses yesterday. On two occasions, she said, neither I nor my predecessor saw that paper. What she didn't say was whether or not the Deputy First Minister had seen the paper. And that was not clear.
Or her spouse.
That was not clear or transparent government. And as the member says, she may not have seen it. It may be because those surrounding her chose not to let her see it.
Call Mr. William Irwin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This motion from the Lions Party comes just a few short months after the DUP, as the largest party in the executive, was returned once again as the largest party in Northern Ireland. It must be pointed out, well, there's a reason for that, I'm sure the electorate make the decision. It must be pointed out that this motion also comes a few months following the Lions Party's departure from that same executive. Having walked the streets of Newry and Armagh for weeks before May's Assembly election, I was encouraged by the support of voters for the DUP. Many took the time on the doorstep to outline their support for our role within the executive. Our First Minister and my party leader Arlene Foster's vision for Northern Ireland resonated with the electorate. And the positivity of what she presents matched with her enthusiasm for the role as First Minister. Is proving that Northern Ireland has and will continue to thrive within the United Kingdom under her leadership. As the opening weeks of this new term have shown, the opposition within the Assembly is struggling to come with any meaningful business. What in effect has been seen from the opposition is opposition within the opposition. In other legislatures where an opposition is present, there is normally a degree of collaboration. An understanding of purpose, however, for reasons best known to these parties and individuals involved in the opposition, this level of understanding has been very much lacking. The motions tabled on what was termed Opposition Day were on issues not within the power of the executive, rendering the benefit of the motions marginal. And then for this motion to be tabled by the Lions Party today, the accusations of a lack of openness and transparency stand at odds with the record of my party's involvement in the executive and the many developments overseen across the DUP and the ministries. Even in recent days, there has been significant progress in my own constituency, with the Communities Minister Paul Given making a very important announcement in creating additional jobs at the Armagh Social Security Agency offices, an announcement that has been very well received within the wider Armagh area. The Lions Party raises the issues of public trust and confidence within their motion, and in response I give them the type of evidence that garners public trust and confidence. Local to me, and in response to concern I raise, Minister Given delivered a solution to a problem that was brought to his door. Localised delivery on the issues that matter most, that's what the people want. I feel the issue now for the opposition and those engaged in trying to formulate a meaningful opposition is that they know that the electorate they say they represent want to see Northern Ireland flourish. The people that want positive politics, that is the very message the DUP took to the doorsteps and was endorsed wholeheartedly. Indeed, the opposition parties got their answer from the electorate just a few months ago.
Would you
remember your way? I will, yes.
Can I thank the member for giving way, and I note the hyenas over in the corner there. I'd just be interested to know if, in the interest of transparency, was anything held back in relation to the fitness of McGilligan Prison in terms of its infrastructure and perhaps at some later stage, maybe the Alliance Party can tell us how fit for purpose that particular facility is, even for refurbishment.
The member has an extra minute.
Thank the member for his intervention, and indeed that will be very interesting. I believe the opposition has a great dilemma. I believe the opposition has a great dilemma, and I fear they will slip into the trap of opposition for opposition's sake. But that, of course, is a decision for them. And in the meantime, the DUP will continue our plan for delivery, and we will ensure that Northern Ireland will continue to move forward and thrive. Thank you, Speaker.
Call Mr. Alex Maskey.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise on behalf of Sinn Féin to reject the motion on the amendments, and just like to make a number of points, and maybe we could respectfully have a discussion. That's in the gift of the Speaker, not myself. Obviously, Stephen Farrey, on behalf of the Alliance, has raised the motion and spoken to that. But it's actually very interesting that whilst no one has really, apart from some people from the sidelines, nobody has really said that there has been anything illegal or inappropriate or wrong done by various decisions taken or with the delay or non-production of documentation at any given time. At the same time, Stephen Farrey also raises a number of issues which are really policy matters and manifesto commitments that parties have made, and you'll either agree with them or not. Like, for example, to raise the issue of, you know, the Dard minister decentralising the department as somehow or other inappropriate, or the means to deliver that. The fact of the matter is that was a commitment given to the electorate and delivered upon. There are many very good arguments why I say accept there may also be arguments against. The fact of the matter is that was a policy matter taken in the interest of people served by the minister and the executive, I suppose, as a whole. They also suggest for one second that the current Minister for Health is sitting on the Benbow report. I think it's actually quite disgraceful. And I do accept that Mr. Farrey in his presentation, for the most part, was very respectful in his contribution, but I think it's very, very wrong to be implying at all that this minister is sitting on the health report from the Benbow report. No, no, you'll have plenty of time. You'll have all plenty of time. You'll have all plenty of time. You'll have your opposition days, and you'll have all sorts of opportunities to ask your questions. So I have to try and condense what I have to say in just a few short minutes. So what I'm saying is that there are issues, whether it was a Benbow report, whether it was a decentralisation, whether it was executive funding programmes like SIF. All of the executives from the initiation of this Assembly in 1998 had a variation of executive programme funds which allowed, in the first instance, the SDLP and also Unionist Party to establish executive funds by which they could cross-fertilise ideas, fund bigger programmes, including support for children's programmes and all the rest of that. So the fact that an executive, including this one and the previous one, which had also Unionist Party and SDLP involvement, the fact that that executive, this executive, has executive programmes is hardly a surprise, because that has been the practice since the day in Ireland this Assembly was formed in 1998 and 1999. So, as I say, likewise, Mr. Agnew refers to the position around support for the New York flight or the City Airport in Derry. Well, I can understand, and Mr. Agnew is entirely entitled to his opinions, whether to oppose the financial and other support for those initiatives, for those airports and those flights. Entitled to have that opinion, but so is the minister and so is the executive entitled to take some positive action to address those issues. Because I am dare say the vast majority of people right across the north and maybe further afield will also very much welcome the fact that support was given to both the New York flight arrangements on the City Airport in Derry. So those are things which are policies, which are delivery for people. And I have to say that I certainly, and Meg Nesbitt, the chair of the former chair of the OFM-DFM committee, will know, and I presume would confer, that on quite a number of occasions in the last mandate, I, as a member of that committee, supported him in calls to the First and Deputy First Minister to ensure that the committee was treated respectfully and properly, and given papers in time, given proper briefings. I raised that myself within my party. As everybody knows around this table, we've had 3 or 4 years of significant debate in the public around what was called then the dysfunctionality, which was an argument put forward by both the other two parties involved in this amendment and proposal this morning. But there was the argument around dysfunctionality. We all discussed that. Part of the problem, and I think it has been proven, first of all, the public rejected the arguments as to who the fault, where the fault lay, because quite clearly, whether people like it or not, Sinn Féin and the DUP have been returned as the two largest parties, and the two parties who are making the loudest noise about dysfunctionality were the two parties which were rejected as the government parties because people did not trust them. They saw the leaks, the permanent leaking, the systemic leaking from the House talks, the Dormant House talks and executive meetings, leaks which were coming from these parties which were not designed to inform the public but were designed to put
ask
themselves
the member
in a better
to conclude
light
his
public.
Remarks. Call Mr. Colin McGrath.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to contribute to this important debate today. It's a very important debate because over the past number of months, despite this being a new mandate and the various pledges that were made in the Fresh Start Agreement, we have seen the executive, the government parties, close the gaps in terms of providing information rather than loosening the strings. It's more autocratic leadership than joint leadership. And Mr. Speaker, in an era of openness and effective democracy, already in this mandate, we have seen the executive shut down rather than open up government. There's issues surrounding a hidden Brexit paper, the use of prerogative powers to appoint a press secretary, and allegations linking a certain political party to the dealings of the NAMA Project Eagle Sale. They have all undermined the democratic processes of this House. They may fly in the face of due process, and I won't even mention about the rule of law. Only last week we heard through the excellent work of the detail with an FOI request that a 15-page document was drawn up by the European and Policy Unit in the Executive Office which listed 20 ways in which an EU exit would hit the Northern Ireland economy. The document noted that we could lose access to €862 million in structural funds and European Social Fund, €2.5 billion in common agricultural policy funding, and loss of access to competitive EU funding. Mr. Speaker, if we're operating within an open and transparent government, we have to ask ourselves, why was this document not released? Was it not surely in the public interest? And the only conclusion that I have is that it was at odds with the DUP's ridiculous position on the referendum and that they certainly didn't want it. And that Sinn Féin, who supposedly wanted to remain but didn't even register as a campaigner, were happy to go along with the DUP agenda. And I do not agree with the Deputy First Minister's claim that these statistics were already in the public domain. The unit that compiled the report had expert knowledge of the EU and its relationships with the North, and this information didn't make its way into the public domain despite it being clearly in the public interest. And then, Mr. Speaker, of course, we have the issue of the monitoring round bids, with information about departmental priorities being made available for committees to scrutinise. And in our new era of openness and transparency, this has been closed down. We are shut out. We're told, you're in the opposition now, just get on with it. I have to say, I love the DUP and Sinn Féin's approach to openness and transparency. They tell you nothing. And Mr. Speaker, then we look at the recent appointment of David Gordon as the executive media spin doctor. Further issues about secrecy and transparency rise. Prerogative powers are meant for the most serious of issues, and they were used in this case to bypass employment law. Mr. Speaker, that is not what these powers were designed for, and it's ironic that Sinn Féin, a supposedly Republican party, was happy enough to bow to the Queen and accept her royal prerogative. Mr. Speaker, perhaps the biggest financial crisis facing this institution and the wider North has been the NAMA sale and Project Eagle. There have been serious allegations made against certain executive parties. There have been moves, Mr. Speaker, to prevent the House from conducting a committee inquiry, despite legal advice stating that there is no conflict here with the NCA criminal investigation. So again, we have to ask ourselves, what is being covered up? I look forward to the spirit of openness and transparency and to hearing what the ministers will say. But unfortunately, as it appears, we don't have a single minister from our executive prepared to be brave enough to come down and hear what they don't want to hear, and that is that the public of the North are interested in openness and transparency. I fear that the public might perceive it as a tactical and willful obstruction of this House and its processes that no minister would come down and give us a response. I welcome the amendments that have been tabled here today, Mr. Speaker. The amendment from Mr. Agnew, which is tabled jointly with my SDLP colleagues, which calls on a commissioner to investigate breaches of the ministerial code. I support this, especially concerning the withholding of the EU document, and then also the joint Ulster Unionist amendment, which calls for the First and Deputy First Minister to act, and that is very welcome. So, Mr. Speaker, I urge the support of this motion and the amendments.
Call Mr. Christopher Stalford.
Mr. Speaker, sir. Mr. Speaker, today we could be talking about health or education or roads or jobs or anything. But no. Instead, the bold, brave opposition under the leadership of the member for Strangford is interested instead in an insiderish political bubble type story that will not put one loaf of bread on anyone's table. And this I think speaks. Do you want me to give way?
The member, and of course it's interesting today that we don't have a minister, but we have a collection of wannabe ministers here to here to seek to impress those who they think their future lies in their hands. But when the member pontificates about not debating all these issues, that of course is a mere distraction from a party which has made a lifetime existence out of failing to come to this House.
Mr. Speaker, no one will ever accuse you of being a wannabe minister.
The member has an extra minute.
Just a wannabe. The fact of the matter is, Mr. Speaker, that they had the opportunity to use their precious time in the Assembly to talk about issues that are of real import to the people out there, and this, instead, is how they decide to use their time. I think that speaks volumes. The motion refers to ongoing problems. Well, the definition that I have of ongoing would be continuing or still in progress, which means they must have started at some point. I presume that means they started when the Ulster Unionist Party, the Alliance and the SDLP were in government? Or is it simply the case that the problems are so... Well, if they started then, why did you not speak in the House then on them? The fact of the matter is, Mr. Speaker, no. The fact of the matter is, Mr. Speaker, that the problems are not as they describe, but the fact is that what we're having now is an attempt by three parties who decided, well, two of which decided to walk away from their opportunity to serve in government. Instead, we're having time wasted with stuff like this. The member from South Down referred to royal prerogative powers being used. I asked him to give way, and he refused so to do. But I'm glad to take this opportunity to remind the member that when the Ulster Unionist Party and the SDLP were the largest parties in this chamber, Mr. Trimble and Mr. Mallon, the then First Minister and Deputy First Minister, also used those powers by way of making a public appointment. And I don't recall, I understand, I think there's probably very few people who were here at that time, but I don't recall the outrage that we hear from others about the use of royal prerogative powers. When they say that there's not proper accountability or scrutiny in this House, what they're really saying is that they're not up to the job. This is supposed to be the opposition. This is supposed to be the power. This is supposed to, I'll give way to Robin. I'll give way to Robin in a few seconds. This is supposed to be the power. I like people from North Antrim. It's Mr. Alistair and then I like North Antrim. It always sends a good DUP squad here. When I hear people say that there's no proper scrutiny in this place, what they're saying is that they're failures at the job of opposition. When they say that they want the information and they want this access to this, access to that, what they're really saying is they want the government to do the job for them. Having elected to be irrelevant on the sidelines, they now want the government to assist them because being in opposition is too much like hard work. I'll give way to Mr. Swan.
Thank you very much, Christopher Stubb. You know what we want. As an opposition, what we really want is ministers to answer us, ministers to appear in this chamber and actually respond to the opposition rather than hiding away at champagne receptions.
I suspect I'm happy to. The numerous references to the champagne reception. I really look, Robin, I promise you, I'll get you an invite for next year. You know, you were out with us. You were out with us.
Order.
I think, Mr. Speaker,
order.
We should make it an annual occurrence because the rate at which people are leaving the Ulster News Party to join the DUP, Robin might be in with us next year, so he'd be more than welcome. Mr. Speaker, the opposition today, when they decry the inability to hold ministers to account, they are effectively admitting that they're not up to the job themselves. Some comment was made, and I would like to respond to it because I've spoken about this before in the House. Some comment was made about the Social Investment Fund. The greatest criticism that I have of the Social Investment Fund is that it took too long to deliver it. And I accept that it took too long to deliver
it. Ask the member to conclude his remarks.
Yes. What I would say, Mr. Speaker, is the Social Investment Fund is delivering and will deliver massive improvements to some of the communities that I represent, and those projects were selected independently and fairly, Mr. Speaker.
I rise to oppose the motion and the amendments. Firstly, we're all for openness and transparency, and we're all for and we're all for inclusive government and positive government. It's ironic that the parties that are laughing there walked away from the executive and are now complaining that they don't know what's going on within the executive. When they were there, they adopted a negative agenda, opposing almost everything, routinely voted against every initiative and every budget. That I could accept if they were proposing alternatives, but they weren't. It was a political strategy to oppose everything. It was a failure of collective leadership and a failure to demonstrate any kind of positive of collective leadership. We had the election, as people mentioned, on May the 5th. The electorate had their say, and as a result, the same parties find themselves taking up the negative agenda in the backbenches in opposition. They've walked away from the responsibilities of governing and delivering for the people that elected all of us in this House. Last week we had a debate, what looked like an opposition day. Two out of the three motions tabled were not in the competence of this Assembly. Yes, I want to see rural banks stay open, particularly in Baleek, from my own constituency, but it's misleading to raise people's expectations that we can resolve the issue within the context of this Assembly. The same with the changes to the pensions that impacted on women born in the 1950s. And again, an important issue, but one that cannot be dealt with in this Assembly. There was a motion on roads maintenance, and a member, he's not here today, from my own constituency, led this House to believe that there hadn't been a pound spent on the roads in Fermanagh in decades. The reality was that the minister, the new minister, Chris Hazard, announced a roads initiative, millions of pounds, which have been rolled out on 56 roads in Fermanagh at this moment. That is positive, constructive leadership, dealing with real issues that affect people's daily lives, not carping from the sidelines. Not once during the debate did the opposition come up with a constructive idea. And the SDLP walked away from the health portfolio. It was handed them, they refused, they sat on their hands. And when I hear SDLP members raise issues in my own constituency, whether it's the GP's crisis, adult learning funding, or services in Enniskillen, they should let everybody know from the outset. We were being offered the portfolio, but we didn't take it. We want to sit on the sidelines. No, I'm not giving way. Can Collier, it reminds me of someone who refuses to take the manager of a football team and then continues to criticise from the sidelines. A well-known and successful GA manager said once when he was asked about his distractors, empty vessels make most noises. These two parties were elected to deliver, and that's what we're doing. Gormila Mayogat.
Call Mr. Gordon Lyon.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I know the opposition don't like to, or the speakers that have spoken today don't like to be reminded of this fact, but this is an issue that is, and I think Mr. Farrey alluded to this, this is seen as a stormont bubble issue. This is seen as something that doesn't really affect the majority of the lives of the people that we represent. I think back over the last week and the issues that, no I won't, the issues that people have raised with me over the last week. It's been about broadband, about special needs education, about social housing and agriculture and road safety and all of those other things. So I defend the right of the Alliance Party and other parties to bring whatever motion they want before the House. That is their right, and they have the opportunity to do that. But I do not think that this is an issue that is high in the public concern. And I think that that demonstrates perhaps the reason why the DUP had a good election and some of the other parties to my right did not. And I know also that the members don't like to be reminded of that, because I know they get very annoyed when they are reminded about the electoral mandate that we have come to this House with. And what I do have to say is, in terms of lack of public confidence and lack of trust that people have up here, I actually think that whenever we spend time speaking on these issues, I think we actually lose some of the trust and confidence of the public, because the public think, here they go again, talking about process, talking about issues that appear to pertain to what is going on in this building rather than what is going on outside. But the member has had his opportunity to bring a motion, and we will address it. The members have spoken about openness and transparency in this place, and I think that a lot of the scrutiny of the executive and a lot of the scrutiny of legislation has to take place within committees. And now the members will all say, oh, but we're not very good at doing that, or we're not able to do that, or we haven't had success in doing that. Well, use the powers that you have. And if you don't believe that you have the powers, ask for the powers. You know, we hear so much about constructive opposition, but all we have had here today is a whinging session from the other members. And what is this all about today? This is all about opposition. This isn't actually about the executive. This isn't actually about openness and transparency. This is about the opposition struggling to come to terms with the fact that they are no longer in government. They have had one foot in and one foot out of government over the last number of years. And now that you've all had your time, and I'm sure you will have time later on, Mr. Ford, and you can respond to me.
The member's indicated that he is not willing to give way. All members should not persist.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So we have an opposition here that is struggling to come to terms with it. Mr. Speaker, I will not be giving way in the near future to members until I get through a few more of these points that I want to make. This is about opposition. This is about the poor quality of opposition. And what is it that over the last number of days that the Ulster Unionist Party have crowed about the most? What have they been most concerned about? The fact that the DUP are hosting a champagne reception at the DUP or at the Conservative Party conference. I never stood on an electoral platform with them, so the members should be very careful. That's what this is all about. This is the fact that they have nothing of any substance to bring, and they focus on these process issues
and these other things. That's what this is all about, Mr. Speaker. And I think that the opposition, and I wish them well in their task, but I think that the opposition need to learn to do their job a little bit better, not to rely upon journalists to do their job for them, and not to rely upon the executive to do their job for them, because that is what is happening at the minute. So if the members have any positive suggestions that they want to bring about how we can be more open and transparent, I'm sure that those will be listened to. But do not expect other people to do your job for you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, just on commencement, before I get into the motion or the amendments, just in response to Mr. Stillford's invitation to join the DUP, it's not the first I've received, but I'll give you the same answer as I gave every other one. Never.
Never.
Never. And never. And that came from North Antrim as well. Mr. Speaker, the currency of leadership is transparency. And if we use that measure here today in the response of the executive, this executive is bankrupt. Because this executive has failed to send a single member to address this issue of openness, of transparency, and the concerns that have been raised by a significant number of members in this House. And I think that's where the failure lies. Openness and transparency are the key weapons that the people of Northern Ireland have, that the opposition in this place have, to hold this government to account. And if you fail to deliver openness and transparency, the people begin to engender a sense of dishonesty and corruption by default and deliver neither of those two. And that's where this place is in danger of becoming today, that we don't look to the openness and transparency that can be delivered. And I've listened to both the DUP and Sinn Féin contributions who want to deflect away from the real concerns, actually concerns that their own MLAs have raised in this place at different times, actually concerns that their own MLAs have raised in committees in this House. And Mr. Lyons spoke about using the powers. OFM-DFM committee were nearly forced to use them powers to bring OFM-DFM to account and to bring them in front of them. They shouldn't have to. That's the point. The minister should be open and transparent about their policies and their beliefs and what their executive is trying to deliver, that they shouldn't be afraid to hide behind. Royal prerogative. They shouldn't be afraid to hide behind monitoring rounds that no longer come before committees. No matter if committees asked for them, Mr. Lyons, because I can assure you they have. And we've been told, no, you're not getting the monitoring rounds. You'll see them when they're done, like the last time. And that only came about.
The member be aware that that is one of the great arguments about opposition was we want to move towards a more Westminster style of doing things. That is precisely how things are done in Westminster in terms of monitoring rounds. And similarly, in terms of the budget, the Chancellor of the Exchequer generally gives the budget to the Leader of the Opposition about 45 minutes before he rises to his feet to deliver it in the House of Commons.
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I accept the member's intervention. And I think opposition is about bringing this place to be more open and transparent. If the member sees his executive as a role that takes that backward step as to using other places as a reason to hide what they're doing, I think they're wrong. And they should be using the ability and the procedures that we had in this House, the procedures that were established in this House, and procedures that were actually practised by his ministers in the past in regard to monitoring rounds. That it was only came about when this executive came about that those monitoring rounds started to become secretive and done behind doors. I'll give way to Mr. Fung.
Thankful for the member giving way. If the DUP want to use Westminster as their benchmark, would Mr. Swan agree with me that in Westminster it wouldn't be tolerated if papers were late for committees, if ministers weren't showing up frequently, if announcements were being made by press release as opposed to on the floor of the House of Commons where backbench MPs can actually hold ministers to account?
I fully accept the member's contribution, because this place is not Westminster. If it was as simple as that, we'd been drinking champagne with the DUP. And moving back to Mr. Farrey's contribution there, and Mr. Irwin's contribution, he hailed as community ministers who came to Newry and Armagh and made the great job announcement in regard to communities and what was being done there. That was great for your constituents. What about the other offices that were closed, that the representatives in this House, representatives from your own party, didn't get a chance to ask your minister? You know why it wasn't done in here? Because they didn't have the answers. It's about going out and giving sweeties to the people to try to keep them happy. It's about substitutes rather than being accountable politically to this place. Mr. Speaker, I do have some sympathy to the DUP and the Sinn Féin contributors today, because it's obvious that they are the lobby fodder of the parties, because their ministers failed to show to be accountable to this motion and to this debate that we're having today. And I know much has been said that we're using this time, we're not using it in broadband, we're not using it in special needs. The point of this motion and the amendments is so when it comes to debates on broadband and special needs, and when broadband and special needs are being debated in this House and projects are being delivered by ministers, that we as elected representatives have the opportunity not just to question, but also to contribute to that debate and to shape that policy. The special needs inquiry that was put through the Employment and Learning Committee prior to devolution is something that should be delivered in this House by ministers.
Call Mr. Edwin Poots.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and we've heard quite a bit from the opposition today in issues around transparency. And I think my colleague, Mr. Stalford, did point out quite correctly, it is the job of opposition to probe, to question, to seek out, to find information. It is not the job of the government to hand it all to them. And it is a job of government to deliver and to ensure that delivery is carried out. And very often, releasing information in advance of that can actually inhibit delivery, because very often we will have people who will come in and seek to exploit things for party political interests as opposed to the interests of the public. And it is incredibly important that those people who actually are in government carry out their work in a way which is proficient and which ensures that delivery happens. That is what is fundamentally important to the public out there. It's delivery on the ground, not the issue that is being raised. I'll give way to Mr. Ford.
I'm grateful for the fact that at least one member of the DUP has the grace to give way, and I thank Mr. Poots for that, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Poots and I have both been in this House since 1998. The 1998 Northern Ireland Act specifies the role of committees is to advise and assist ministers. Perhaps Mr. Poots could now explain how that is to be their function if they're not given any information by ministers.
The member has an extra minute.
Well, I thank the member for his intervention. I had rather hoped that he would deal with the issue of McGilligan, which I had posed earlier on, but he failed to do that in terms of not telling people what's going on. Oh, I would welcome that, because I think that there could be something interesting in relation to it. Nobody's suggesting the committees aren't given information. Who is actually suggesting that the committees are not given information? And I've always found in my past role that sometimes members can get information that wasn't previously made available to ministers. Sometimes civil servants don't want all of the information available to go to ministers. So I always welcomed questions being asked, good probing questions that got to the issues and that could assist a minister in the execution of their duties. Mr. Alistair asked many questions and he referred to wannabe ministers. Mr. Alistair, of course, is a wannabe leader of unionism, which has never happened for him. He's a wannabe MP, but Ian Paisley showed him a very clean pair of heels when he made that attempt. So we'll not be taking any lectures from Mr. Alistair about wannabes. But 6.5 years of it, so it didn't do too badly, you know. It took a brave while to catch me on. but in terms of this, we are here today, and what we are interested in, as a government, as an executive, as a party of government, is delivery for the people of Northern Ireland. You know, the issue was raised today, earlier on, about breast cancer and about the issues around that. Those are the issues that are of fundamental importance, and Mr Durkin, in fairness, has a question down on that. Those are the issues which are of fundamental importance. The opposition, and I know that they're just finding their feet, appear to be clambering about and taking a stab here and taking a stab there without any real coherence. They appear to be somewhat leaderless and rudderless, and actually having Mr Nesbitt as leader of the opposition is somewhat worrying for those of us who would like to see an effective opposition in this House, because, after all, he is a failed political leader, and virtually every election he goes into, he comes out with the worst result. Yes, Mr Agnew.
Member giving way. There's been an attempt to turn this into somehow an irrelevance, only relevant to the people in this room. When Arlene Foster issued a licence for Frecken and Fermanagh, there was a public position which I presented to this Assembly. There was protests. There was huge public interest. The complaints that came to Standards and Privileges Committee against ministers were members of the public. This is an issue of importance to the public.
Well, certainly, the member has raised many issues on environmental issues, and many of them I will disagree with. I would much prefer that if there is resources available here in Northern Ireland, that we look at that and we see if we can use those resources for the population in Northern Ireland, as opposed to importing, you know, oil from regions in the Middle East and Africa and gas from Siberia and so forth, where very often much poorer environmental conditions would actually be applied. So if you're looking at the global earth, it would be much better to actually do the thing right here than import it from somewhere else and ignore what's actually going on. And perhaps Mr Agnew would reflect that in his green policies. Is it just green here in Northern Ireland, or is it green elsewhere? But certainly, those are issues which we're very happy to take on. Those are issues which we're happy to debate. I think the issue that's in front of us today is, for the general public, a non-issue, and it's brought forward by a somewhat rudderless opposition.
And I call Mrs. Emma Little-Pengelly. Ms. Pengelly.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And thank you for the opportunity to rise to speak on this debate today. I think actually it's a little sad that some of the members who were here this morning are not present in the chamber to hear my contribution to this debate. I think it is both sad and disappointing because of the tone and the attitude in relation to this debate. The scoffing and the sneering of those sitting on the benches opposite, and I include the opposition, the second opposition, and the, I can't believe it's not the opposition. The scoffing and the sneering from this morning's debate, I think, is a sad reflection on politics in Northern Ireland. We are committed to positive politics. I spoke to many, many thousands of people, and I know what they want is for us to deal constructively with real issues, like the issue that we've been speaking about in terms of breast cancer, issues in relation to health and education, issues in relation to affordable childcare. Those are the issues that matter to people. But trying to scoff and faux laughter in terms of the points made by people in this House, as demonstrated this morning, are people repeatedly rising in their place in terms of interventions to be destructive in speeches. I don't think that's what politics should be about. It should be about respect. And I think there's lots to reflect on in terms of that debate today. In terms of the substantive motion, I think today should be a bit of a wake-up call for people, because people need to realise that if you opt out of being in the executive, you're not in the executive. You're not going to have the same influence in terms of government policy. You're not going to get the same access to information as government ministers have in order to formulate that policy. That is a real issue. It needs to be a wake-up call for people in this House that things have changed, and they've changed for a reason, because parties have opted out of being in the executive. There was a point raised earlier on in relation to the Assembly powers and scrutiny. Scrutiny is necessary, scrutiny is right, but we have a range of different mechanisms within the Assembly and within the Executive and within Northern Ireland in terms of that scrutiny. Ministers are scrutinised by departments. This Assembly has a role, but it is set down in our very constitution, in the very mechanisms and structures of this body, that the Assembly has certain duties and the Executive has certain duties. There is a separation of those powers. And that is pretty fundamental in terms of constitutions. Yes, I will.
I thank the member for giving way. She makes a valid point in relation to the scrutiny powers of the Assembly, but how does she suggest that the like of the OFM-DFM committee execute those powers if the First and Deputy First Minister hold it within such contempt as to not attend it for over a whole year?
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you, Speaker. You know, the member doesn't live in a bubble, and he didn't live in a bubble back when there were serious issues happening within the Assembly, within the executive. Everybody was aware of that. And there was a commitment to try to get through that. And I do think the circumstances that he has spoken about was placed within that context at that time. But I do think that the member should welcome that the parties in government have said very clearly, we want to improve mechanisms, we want to work together constructively, we are listening to people who want constructive and positive politics, and that is what we are going to deliver. And I've heard some strange contributions in this chamber already today in relation to who has the greatest control, who's answerable to whom. And I do think that perhaps it would be useful for us to have some basic understanding of the executive powers, of the assembly powers, and prerogative powers. One of the oldest traditions within the great British constitution, and apparently for some people in this house, it's like they woke up and just simply discovered it existed. I think Claire admitted that she wasn't aware of the background to the issue, but Mike Nesbitt and others as well, that this power that has been around for many, many decades suddenly appeared from nowhere. So members do need to understand that there is a division, there should be scrutiny, but I do want to emphasise in conclusion that all members should be respectful. And I honestly think that this morning's debate was a disgrace in terms of the lack of respect and the scoffing and the sneering. And do you know what? That is not what people want, and that's why people are not voting for that. And they're voting for those parties to say, we are going to work at this and we're going to deliver better outcomes for the people of Northern Ireland. Sorry.
I call Mr. Jim Allister.
Mr. Speaker, the Kingdom of Marvin. What a dark and secret place, where boundless energy is expended on keeping secret their hidden things of darkness. No better example than the recent abuse over the amendment of the Civil Service Commissioner's Order 2016. When the executive office went through all sorts of contortions to seek to conceal why and when and how the law was changed. Took it to the point of when an investigative journalist, Mr. McBride, asked, what's the legislation you're using? They provided the incomplete answer, the Civil Service Commission Amendment Order, without daring to reveal that it was the order made 2 weeks before in 2016. Why? Because they wanted to conceal that they'd used the executive prerogative powers. The mischief here, of course, is not the making of the appointment. Many would say this executive needs all the help it can get from people like Mr. Gordon. The mischief here was in the manner in which they surreptitiously changed the law. And Henry VIII style rewrote the law. We think we are members of a legislative assembly. That cons us into believing that we make the laws. But oh no, not when Henry VIII style, Arlene Foster and Martin McGuinness decide they will make the law. They'll not even tell the Assembly. Indeed, they'll go to great lengths to conceal it from the Assembly. And the truth has to be dragged out of them. And then we have protestations about anyone daring to raise questions of openness and transparency. Of course, the appointment itself of Mr. Gordon is pregnant with irony. One of Ian Paisley's most memorable assaults on journalists was when agitated by the lawful use of freedom of information legislation. He turned and used and said it was being abused by lazy journalists. Of course, one of the lazy journalists in his terms was David Gordon, who used it more than most to great effect. And of course, the irony now is that the Bete Noire is now the spin doctor of this executive. And then we had some remarkable things said in this debate. We had Mr. Edwin Poots tell us it was not the job of government to reveal information. And we had Mr. Irwin reading from his script tell us, well, we won the election, so just suck it up. There was nothing in either the manifesto of Sinn Féin or their partner, the DUP, which said, we're wanting a mandate for secrecy, for chicanery, for tyranny. No, there was protestations in those manifestos of delivering for people through the Assembly and through the Executive, not to mention that their primary purpose and function and focus would be on concealing that which it didn't suit them to reveal. And I think it is abundantly clear that this Executive has abused its powers enormously. Hence, the sensible amendment of Mr. Agnew that we need a process to hold those to account who do abuse the ministerial code.
I call Ms. Claire Hannah to wind on amendment number 2, and the member has 5 minutes.
Speaker, I think this has been a timely discussion. Everybody's getting used to the new dispensation of government and opposition, and it is useful to shed some light on some of the less constructive practices of the government. The need for transparency obviously isn't unique to Northern Ireland. Everywhere, people have a right to know the processes behind decisions and the decisions being made and their money being spent. And no matter how cranky the executive are about being left in government on their own, they have to play by those rules as well. In the debate, members have outlined some of the gaps and failings of this executive. Something of a greatest hits of poor governance have been introduced by various speakers. We've discussed delay after delay and excuse after excuse on the NABA inquiry, including the government parties joining forces to water down an Assembly motion. We've discussed the use of royal prerogative to appoint more advisers, despite the provision being available to appoint them, and the failure to acknowledge the substance of concerns in this. It isn't the inequality of arms, yet more spin doctors. It isn't the headhunting of somebody that we all acknowledge is talented. It's the fact that this issue, not the many, many issues and the many policies and the many strategies that have not come out of this executive because of inertia and dysfunction, it was this issue that you chose to jump the legislative queue. And perhaps if it was something that affected real people rather than feathering this government's nest, people wouldn't be so annoyed. We discussed the secret Brexit report and indeed the two stories we're getting on that. The First Minister is telling us she knew nothing about it. The Deputy First Minister is telling us he wasn't allowed to release it because of that. We've discussed government by press release, the rush always to the click of cameras instead of to the scrutiny afforded by this chamber. That happened with the paramilitary report, it happened with the filleting of the NAMA motion, and it happens in the week after week refusal to meaningfully answer questions that aren't just softballs from the backbenches in oral questions. We discussed the failures of a bad budgeting process that's getting worse with the withholding even of the in-year bid information, which is a key tool for government scrutiny. We discussed the fact that they haven't even got their story straight. In answers to questions from the SDLP, the Communities and Areas Ministers explicitly told us, we are now in a different environment with the introduction of an official opposition, therefore processes have changed. But when the Deputy First Minister was asked the same issue, he said, obviously there was a problem over the June monitoring round. We will do everything in our power to ensure we meet the requirements that committees are accorded the respect they deserve. Mr. Poots, in his contribution, at least had the honesty to tell us that information inhibits delivery and that it's the opposition's job to force the information out of government. An honourable mention has to go I will in a moment. The honourable mention has to go to the walking exercise in bad governance that is the Social Investment Fund. Again, the rebuttals are deliberately missing the point. Nobody in this chamber is denying the need that exists in our communities, but nobody in this government will explain why that money isn't subject to open tenders, why it is an invite-only fund, why there is no transparent criteria, and how the multi-layered conflicts of interest are being managed, let alone how people who are affected by paramilitarism are supposed to have confidence when people inextricably linked to live paramilitarism are being funded to address their social problems. Members have correctly pointed out the arrogance of this government not sending one single member. We have a few more members in, or one single minister minding the shop. Mr. Swan referred to, I see even it has scarpered the empty glass on the table. It was at least as empty as the contributors, but at least it was transparent. Members in the parties that were in the executive were being lectured about how we won't get that information because we're not in the executive. We didn't get that information when we were in the executive. We were given key documents minutes before those meetings. So those members as well who want to tell us that we've never had it so good governmentally and critique the UUP SDLP executive, no, I've got a few things to get through, in the early years of the government, neglect to mention that their parties were outside using every tool, parliamentary and otherwise, to tear down that executive. Sinn Féin hasn't tired of telling us how, now that we lost the election, we should just go home and not make any political points in 4 years, because that's exactly how the opposition conducts itself in the Dáil. If that's not partitionist, I don't know what is. Mr. Lyons said that they are open to transparency if we would just bring forward the proposals. This is what we're doing. Bring forward the proposals. Let us have the NAMRA inquiry. Give us the in-year monitoring around. Support our reasonable proposal to enforce the ministerial code. I don't have time to go over all the arguments from the backbenches that are usually one of three or four simple categories, but I will say this executive would make members of the pre-1972 Stormont executive blush.
I call Mr. Alex Atwood to wind on amendment number one, and the member will have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Could I remind people what Mr. Agnew's amendment says? Calls for the creation of a standards commissioner for the executive to investigate alleged breaches of the ministerial code. If there is, Mr. Speaker, a defining feature of democracy and the best practice of democracy in this part of Ireland over the last 40 years, it is the fact that we have oversight and accountability. There was once a time when we didn't have it on policing, so we had to go off and create it through Patton and the Policing Board. There was once a time we did not have it on police complaints, so we had to go off and create the police ombudsman. There was once a time that we didn't have it on housing, and we had to create the housing executive, and so on and so forth. I will shortly. The defining feature of the best practice of democracy after the abuses of democracy in this part of Ireland has been oversight and accountability across the full range of public policy. Now, we know, Mr. Speaker, that year in and year out, the DUP resisted all of that accountability and transparency. The question is, why today does Sinn Féin, who tend to make an argument that they embrace these new models of accountability, resist Stephen Agnew's amendment? Because what it does is create ministerial accountability in a way that we did not have before. So I understand that it's in the DNA of the DUP to resist accountability because they've done it for decades. It is allegedly not in the DNA of Sinn Féin, yet today they will vote down a quite moderate measure that would see accountability in respect of the ministerial code. Why? I give way to the member.
The member made reference to the Northern Ireland Housing Executive being created sort of in an open way as a result of the civil rights campaign in the late 1960s. Is it not ironic, as my point to the member, is it not ironic that right now the Northern Ireland Housing Executive is being dismantled in secret, as powers handed over to the Strategic Investment Board, a fact which we would only know if we had contacts in the Housing Executive, deeply upset about this, giving us the information. Is this not ironic in the middle of a debate on transparency and accountability?
Yes, it is. And it's also
the member has an extra minute.
That people are trying to drive a coach and horses through the good work of the Housing Executive of 40 or 50 years. Yes, they lost their way in some ways, but that is no excuse for the DUP to drive a coach and horses through its good authority. There is also, Mr. Speaker, an enormous inconsistency between this week and last week. Remember what the DUP and Sinn Féin voted through last week. Quote, support all efforts to uncover the truth and commit to full cooperation with all ongoing investigations. Those were the standards, allegedly, of the DUP and Sinn Féin when it comes to NAMA. Yet when they have an opportunity in Stephen Agnew's amendment to do what? To support all efforts to uncover the truth and commit to full cooperation with all ongoing investigations, such as would happen if the Commissioner for Standards had that power, what do? They vote it down. Would they please explain, if they were so keen on these principles last week, why not this week? The most astounding speech came, as often is the case, from Miss Little Pengelly, where, consistent with all the DUP speakers today, Mr. Speaker, she said, well, actually, this is a consequence of going into opposition. This is how government does its business, because you decide to go into opposition. What an affront to those who have struggled for democracy to be told that if you go into opposition, then you go into the darkness, and so does truth, and so does public accountability. The message today for the DUP and Sinn Féin, I'll be very clear about it, is that we won, so we do. And whether it's for the parties in this chamber or for the people out there, whether it's in respect of Brexit, NAMA, Fresh Start, Budget, Legacy, because that's going to come next, the DUP, Sinn Féin, the British government are going to impose their will when it comes to Legacy, just as they're trying to impose their will when it comes to all of these issues. I don't quote him. I don't think I've ever quoted him, but I'm going to quote him today. 40 years ago, somebody made a speech in the Dimbleby Lecture. It was, of all people, Lord Hailsham. And Lord Hailsham, wherever he may be at the moment, will have a smile on his face, Mr. Speaker, because he anticipated what we see happening in this sort of democracy that the DUP and Sinn Féin imposed. He talked about executive dominance. He talked about an elective dictatorship. We see the reality of that in the conduct of this debate and the practice of democracy as the DUP and Sinn Féin see it.
I call Mr. David Ford to conclude and wind up the debate on the motion, and the member will have 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. When my colleagues and I tabled this motion, we did it as a relatively broad-based motion, not seeking to prescribe specific issues, but to highlight issues and to allow a wide-ranging, high-level debate. That's what Stephen Farrey said when he was making the proposal. And it's absolutely clear that we got that kind of open and high-level debate with some additional specific points. Well, we got it from this end of the chamber, Mr. Speaker, because we certainly didn't get it from the other end. I just go quick.
I agree with me that it's highly ironic that on a debate about openness and transparency, that one party was completely shut out of the debate and wasn't allowed to speak.
Well, I'm afraid I'll have to leave Mr. Carroll to raise that with you, Mr. Speaker. I wouldn't possibly wish to intrude on your good offices towards me by agreeing, though it does actually illustrate something of the rules of this chamber and the fact that we base speaking rights on solely numbers and not variety of ideas, with the result that certain people get much less opportunity, which, given the paucity of the contributions that came from the other end of the chamber, perhaps does require some re-examination by the Business Committee. I'll give way.
Would the member be interested to know that when other parties in the Business Committee tried to adjust speaking order so that the smaller parties would have speaking rights and would have been heard today, it was the DUP and Sinn Féin voted down that proposal.
Point of order.
Mr. Speaker, I was on the business committee when that went through. Sinn Féin voted at the smaller parties, so Mr. Atwood should be asked to withdraw because he's actually economical with the truth.
On a point of order,
I don't believe that is a point of order, Mr. Atwood.
On a point of order, the reason why I'm right is that that's the decision of the recent business committee, which Mr. McCartney does not sit on. It is a matter of record that the new business committee voted DUP Sinn Féin to suppress the rights of smaller parties.
The minutes of the committee meeting are available for members to peruse.
Mr. Speaker, I've lost 45 seconds to points of order. Clearly, when the motion referred to problems with openness and transparency, two parties in this chamber wanted to show to us the problems that they have with openness and transparency. And that has been shown quite clearly, as a number of members have said, by the ministerial absence from this chamber for this debate, despite the fact that the motion and one of the amendments specifically call for executive action, and the presumption would be that there would be an executive minister to respond. At this end, I believe there was genuine discussion at that end of the chamber. There was a complete refusal to engage, shown by the refusal to accept interventions, which does nothing to promote the concept that this is a debating chamber. Indeed, the contributions have already been summed up by a number of others as "we won," or actually "we won, so get lost." I think Mr. Allister's phrase was something on the lines of we won, so suck it up." That's not the concept of democracy that says an election result determines everything for 5 years, because democracy is about engagement, it's about openness, it's about transparency, and everything that has been not shown by the executive parties today.
I thank the member for giving way. Mrs. Little-Pengelly made the point about people being respectful. Would he not agree that it is a complete disrespect to this chamber when ministers make their announcements via press release rather than bringing them by statement to the House, and one that would not be tolerated in places like Westminster, to which the DUP look for guidance?
I would agree, and I'll happily give way to Mr. McCartney if he wishes to give a specific example of where I may have done so.
In relation to the prisons, particularly in McGavery, it was
Can I ask any member who gets an intervention should address their intervention remarks through the chair. Mr. Ford.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'll try to make some progress. We have been accused, those of us at this end of the chamber, of discussing issues which are only of concern in the bubble. Is NAMA and the allegations of potential corruption in this society a matter for the bubble? Is the fact that the Bengoa report, prepared with all-party inclusion in the discussion, sitting since the early part of the summer on a minister's desk and not published, not a matter of public concern, given the special notice question that we had earlier on? Is the cover-up of the budget and the failure to engage in any meaningful discussion with the committees appointed to advise and assist ministers not an issue of concern, the fact that nothing is being done to do that? Is DARD moving its headquarters to Ballykelly with no business case, in a way which is clearly unravelling at the moment, as the executive is rushing around desperately trying to find anybody who's prepared to take desks in a building which has been built with no business case? Is that not an issue of concern? It's the expenditure through SIF, without proper due process, without it being carried out through the departments with the proper responsibility. Is that not an issue of public concern? Of course these are all issues of public concern that two parties wish to cover up. It's the use of the royal prerogative when legislation exists for the appointment of civil servants and exists for the appointment of special advisers already. Is that not an issue? Because we can have historical lectures on how the royal prerogative originated, but this is the 21st century. I understand from Mr. Lynch's contribution during the debate that, referring to the three opposition parties, he said they opposed everything in the executive. He didn't take an intervention from me, because that wasn't the case. And certainly the way in which I treated the committee as a minister was anything but the way he has tried to present the way we did it. Well, Mr. Lyons said that we shouldn't expect others to do the job for us. No, we expect others to provide the information which they are duly bound to provide in terms of the way in which our structures of government are set up, and then we can do our job of scrutinising properly, because this place is not Westminster. This place is set up in a different way, which is supposed to be about partnership and consensus and working together, and that has been completely ignored. Mr. Poots managed to somehow work in the issue of McGilligan Prison. Well, let me tell Mr. Poots what happened around the issue of accommodation of McGilligan. Well, if he were here, but with the bad manners that is customary of a number of those who contributed today, he's not here. Because the prison service set out a plan for capital redevelopment recently, which was praised by a finance minister, who at the time was a member of the DUP, praised for how effective it was, how well it was constructed, but no money was released to do the essential building work in any of the prisons. There was a consultation about the proposals of the review team, which would have closed down McGilligan. And as a result of that consultation, because when I did consultations in the DOJ, they were open, inclusive, and genuine consultations, that proposal was reversed because a good case was made. And the committee was informed all the way through, just the way as the Justice Committee was informed about monitoring rounds, even when they were not part of normal executive processes, because in the early days the DOJ was ring-fenced. So I'll not take any lectures from Edwin Poots or anybody else as to how the DOJ ran. The fact that we've had people attempting to pretend that this place can be Westminster, when all our history since 1972 is that this place cannot be a mini Westminster, is a clear example of their attempt to cover up, although I noticed even Sinn Féin didn't manage excuses like Westminster. And we also need to ensure that we see that the way in which the institutions were set up in 1998 are actually observed in spirit and in practice, and not just as a letter of the law, which is largely ignored. I think I should draw attention that we have a minister. Isn't that amazing? I can no longer say the line that was next coming up. There must be a DUP spy in the gallery with binoculars. That the way in which today's debate has been shown, the complete concept of not a single minister in the House until the last 2 minutes of a debate which lasted an hour and three quarters, is an example of the contempt with which the executive is treating not the opposition, but the people of Northern Ireland and the institutions and the legislation which set up these institutions to provide a different way of doing government, a way built on partnership between executive and committees, between executive and the Assembly, because that's what this place is supposed to be about, and that is absolutely what they're not doing. Whilst it's very welcome to see Mr. Weir finally arrived in, for the purpose of this debate, there was no First Minister, there was no Deputy First Minister, there were no junior ministers, there was no DUP minister until the last 2 minutes, there was no Sinn Féin minister, there wasn't even the Justice Minister present. Yet any one of them could have responded to a motion which was calling for executive action. Any one of them could have been here. So some people may be too busy. Sorry, I thought the Ulster Unionists would have given us a quick quip about drinking champagne in Birmingham, but we've perhaps overdone that analogy. Any one of them could have been here.
If
FM and DFM had not been available, any minister could have done it, yet they just set out their backbenchers to read spurious speeches, refuse interventions, and prove absolutely the point that we were making collectively in this chamber about the lack of openness, the lack of transparency, and the change fundamentally to close matters down, which has happened since the election in May. That said, some of us are well aware of how little was shared within the executive
Member,
at the time.
Members, remarks.
Mr. Speaker, I did lose 45 seconds for point of order.
You don't get an but extra that minute.
But that is the reality of the way the executive has been set up. And I do think that the interesting point in the next few minutes, Mr. Speaker, as we walk through the iLobby in support of two amendments and a motion, will be to see how many ministers who are currently hiding in their rooms around this building turn up to walk through the no lobby.
The question is that amendment number one on the marshal list in the names of Mr. Stephen Agnew, Mr. Alex Atwood, Ms. Claire Hannah, and Mr. Jim Allister be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Members, resume their seats. Members, resume their seats. Members, the question is that amendment number one on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Do we have tellers? Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Mark Durkin and Stephen Agnew. Tellers for the noes are George Robinson and Oliver McMullen. Clear the lobbies. The House will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Order. Members resume their seats. Clerk, read the result.
93 members voted, 35 members voted aye, 58 members voted no. The amendment therefore falls.
The amendment therefore falls. Amendment 1 has not been made. Unfasten the doors. The question is that Amendment number 2 on the Marshall list in the names of Mr Mike Nesbitt, Mr Danny Kennedy, Mr Alex Atwood and Ms Claire Hanna be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I have been advised by the party whips in accordance with Standing Order 27(1)(a) subsection B that there is an agreement that we can dispense with the 3 minutes and move straight to the division. So I now call tellers. Do we have tellers? Members, tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Sinead Bradley and Mike Nesbitt. Tellers for the noes are George Robinson and Oliver McMullen. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Members resume their seats. Clerk, please read the result.
93 members voted, 35 members voted aye, 58 members voted no. The amendment therefore falls.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
No. I think the noes have it. I think the noes have it. The noes have it. Okay, I think we need to go to a division. Say again. Order, members. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Stephen Farry and Kelly Armstrong. Tellers for the noes are George Robinson and Oliver McMullen. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Eyes to my right, noes to my left. Order. Members resume their seats. Clerk, please read the result.
92 members voted, 34 members voted aye, 58 members voted no. The motion falls.